Hello everyone, my name is Pixlriffs and welcome back to the Minecraft Survival Guide. I hope you guys are having a good day, and right at the start of this episode I want to say I'm sorry for the long absence. It's been a little while since we made one of these videos. It feels like it's been at least a week since the Minecraft Survival Guide last came out, and the reason for that is that I've been upgrading my PC and it took a little while to arrive, so I was kind of holding out until the new setup arrived. But I have myself a new PC now, as you guys will know if you watch my Decidedly Vanilla series or you saw the unboxing video that I posted the other day. So right now we are working with a new PC. The Minecraft Survival Guide world has been copied over from my Minecraft saves folder on my old PC to this one, and everything is exactly as it should be. All of the interior design and stuff that we did in the last episode remains in place, and I've been doing a little bit of level gathering off camera because I wanted to get that Depth Strider book that we saw in the enchanting table last time. I've gotten my hands on that, which is fantastic. Depth Strider will allow us to move faster in water if we have it attached to our boots. Right now, the the book came with protection 4 as well, and the boots I already have protection 4, but that's not a problem. I think we can probably combine those. There's no protection 5 enchantment, so that's not going to increase the protection we get, but I feel like that is already looking pretty good, and having Depth Strider on those will be a great advantage. One other thing is that I've been fighting blazes so much to gain levels that my sword durability is nearly at 0, at which point the sword would break, which I don't want to happen. So instead, I made myself another diamond sword, and I thought, what if we put this through the enchantment table to see if we get any interesting enchantments? And looting 3 came up, so I am very excited to get this enchantment. We're going to definitely buy that. And it got sharpness 3 as well, but it's a shame that won't really combine with the sharpness 4 that we already have on the sword. It's also a bit of a shame that it didn't come with unbreaking, because that would definitely help the durability issue. But we can combine these two, and looting 3 will actually allow us to get more chance of mob drops. So anytime we use a looting 3 sword, any enchantment with looting really, but looting 3 is the highest level, you will be able to gather more mob drops from anything that drops items. So for example, if we're fighting blazes in the Nether, they will have a greater chance of dropping at least one more blaze rod if we attack them. Likewise with cows and sheep and so forth, if you're gathering meat and leather and things from them, and I don't think it affects wool. It doesn't affect all mob drops, just certain ones. And so if you want clarification on that, probably best to go to the Minecraft wiki, but it will certainly give you a higher chance of acquiring rare drops, things like leather and so forth. I think it also gives you a higher chance of getting things like crops and iron ingots when you're fighting zombies, that kind of thing. So let's combine those now, because I have a feeling we will definitely need that. We will need the sword to be back in action, and with 22 durability left, that is really not going to last for very long. Let's take a quick look at if you combine it this way around, adding sharpness and looting together that way around, because looting is such a rare enchantment, it's going to cost us 18 levels, whereas if we combine those the other way around, it's only going to cost us 4 to add looting to a sword, because the sharpness is the only one that we're adding, and that's a relatively cheap enchantment. So there we go. We have a looting 3 sharpness 4 sword now. Exciting times. Now, looking back at the enchantment table here, respiration 3 came up. That's quite a good book to have, especially considering our helmet only has protection on it so far. And we could potentially look through some of the other tools and things to see if we could get ourselves a better, like a silk touch pickaxe or something like that. That would be kind of useful. Let's take a quick look there. Nope, another Fortune 3. Okay, well, we have a Fortune 3 pickaxe already, so I'm not going to worry too much about that right now. Could potentially look at enchanting fishing rods or bows or something like that if you wanted to cycle through the enchantments a little bit. Let's take a quick look at the fishing rod just in case we get something nice here. Lure 3. Okay, so that's not too bad, but I feel like I haven't been doing too much fishing lately, so that's not to worry. We will put that back in there. So I think today we are going to explore a little bit further afield now that I have a better PC and I don't have to worry about the lag spikes happening when we're generating new terrain in this world. I think we will probably head a little further afield and see what else we can find. Maybe I will take a map with me, but I think maybe today we can start looking into what external tools you can use to explore your Minecraft world. So for that, we all need the seed number, which I'm going to type /seed in the chat for. And this has been in the description of the videos that I've posted for a long time, so you guys will know this seed number already. And this seed number is actually something that is worth copying. So if you click on it there, I think the green text actually means if you click on it, it will appear in the chat bar here. We can highlight that and we can copy it using Control C. And we're going to take that to a tool on the web which will allow you to input a Minecraft seed, it will generate the terrain, or at least an overview of the terrain, like a giant map of it, and we'll be able to see where some of the stuff in this world is. Okay, folks, welcome to mineatlas.com. This is my mapping tool of choice. This is the one I tend to use, generally speaking. And you'll notice it says unofficial Minecraft 1.8 seed map here. And effectively, this 1.8 is the version of Minecraft when they updated this. And terrain generation has not changed much since Minecraft 1.8. All of the biomes and stuff that generate in our world, while the landscape may be slightly different, most of them will appear in the same place as they would if we generated the world in Minecraft 1.8. So by entering the seed number here, which we copied and pasted like so, and clicking set seed, it will generate a map for us, which will show us our spawn point, it will show us the terrain around it, and it will show us other landmarks that appear nearby. For example, if we click on this, we can find some likely villages. If we click on this, we can find where ocean monuments are likely to appear. You can find things like jungle temples and witch huts and that kind of thing. And this should all be relatively accurate to our world. So as you can see, there are chances of ocean monuments being all over the place. There are two villages which are within reasonable walking distance, and as you mouse around this, you'll notice the coordinates up here in the location details section will change, so you can see exactly where you need to travel to get to a place where a village might appear. In this case, we've got one here with a coordinate of 824 and minus 872, and we've got one here in the opposite direction with coordinates of minus 712, 1192. So we could go to either of those, and we should be able to find a village. There are a few that are further afield as well. Villages typically appear in plains, deserts, and a couple of other biomes, and it's likely that this will change in future because the next update to Minecraft is going to be focused on villages, so we might see them appearing in forests and jungles and things later on as well. But for now, plains and deserts are the places you will usually find them. Let's take a little look further afield, see if there are desert temples. There is a big desert down here, and it looks like there is a desert temple here. So these look like good locations to scout out. It's a little bit further afield than I expected to go. It's around, let's see there, we've got minus 3,1600. And further afield there, we have some other biomes like a mesa. We've got a jungle right there next to the mesa as well. That could be very useful to visit. And some of these other biome colors are going to be kind of interesting to explore too. We've got some cold tiger and some ice plains over here. And we even have a few mushroom islands out here in the ocean, which are going to be really important to explore at some point in future. I'm looking forward to introducing you to all of these, but I don't want to overwhelm you guys with information right at the start here. So let's focus down on the villages first of all. We want to be probably tracking down that village there. I'll take the coordinates of that and make sure that we take a look, see if there is actually a village generated there, because these are, it says likely village because these are not guaranteed to spawn here, especially if the terrain is slightly different. There is a chance that if a village does a check for the surrounding terrain and it can't build stuff there, if the terrain doesn't work for the shape of a village, then chances are the village may not even appear there. So it's always a possibility that we will have to go and explore this one that's slightly further out. But since we've explored quite far north in this world already, I think we can go and give that a try. Let's hop back into Minecraft and see if we can find this village. So before we head out on our trip to see if we can find that village, one thing I should have mentioned before the Mine Atlas segment of this video is that that only works with the Java edition of Minecraft. Unfortunately, I don't know of any tools which allow you to get an overview of Bedrock Minecraft seeds. So folks who are playing the Windows 10 edition or the Pocket edition of Minecraft, I'm sorry, I can't really provide any more information on that. They may be out there as far as I know, but not being a player of the Bedrock edition of Minecraft myself, I'm not aware if any such tools exist. And the Java ones have been out there for quite a long time. So it's the kind of thing where they're well established at this point and there are lots of options available to you. Things like Amidst, Mine Atlas, and I'm fairly sure there are a few others. But for the time being, we're going to set out on our trip. We're going to bring a little bit of stuff with us and we're going to leave some stuff behind. I've already put the lapis and the books and stuff in this chest. I shouldn't be needing any of those. I'm going to take these emeralds because emeralds are used as a currency for trading with villagers. So those will actually be quite useful. And I'm going to take a bed with me, but I'm going to try not to use it because on the way, I would love it if we could encounter some Endermen. The reason I want to encounter some Endermen right now and the reason I'm going to be taking some blaze powder with me, I'm going to break these two blaze rods down into blaze powder, is that one of the next steps in the game requires us to craft Eyes of Ender, which are only accessible to us if we get an Ender Pearl and combine it with Blaze Powder. But those are definitely part of the next steps in our Minecraft world. It's very important that we get hold of some of those. So I'm going to tempt fate. I'm going to stay up at night and I'm going to see if we can acquire us some Endermen on this journey. Now, having looting 3 on our sword is going to be exceptionally helpful for that, because that will mean there is a higher chance of Endermen dropping Enderpearls when we kill them. I'm going to leave my Fortune 3 pickaxe at home as well. I've only got the Unbreaking 3 and Efficiency 1, and the shield here is going to be very important if we end up fighting some Endermen. But, you know, I think we are more or less good to go. Let me just grab a little bit of food that I've been cooking here in the furnaces. I've got some cooked mutton in here as well that I will probably leave in the pantry chest in here. There we go. Fantastic. All kitted out for our trip, and I think we need to head in this direction. Yeah, we were looking at something like plus 800, negative 800 in terms of X and Z coordinates. So we will make our way over there. I think we'll go via the Nether Hub, because we already have a portal out there in the swampland, and chances are we only need to swim a little way east from there, and then we should be able to encounter that village. Hopefully. Let's see if this works. And I've even left a boat here. How about that? All right, let's make our way out this way. And it seemed like there was a decent stretch of ocean connecting those. If we remember back to the map, I'm fairly certain that if we head this way for a good few hundred blocks, we should be able to come around to the top of that area where the village was. So those map overviewers will not show any of the changes to oceans that have occurred in 1.13, because as I mentioned before, it's a 1.8 map generator, so it doesn't have any of the frozen oceans or the lukewarm oceans, any of the shipwrecks or anything like that for 1.13. It's certainly not going to show you these dolphins. Look at the dolphins. Oh, they're so cool. It's always really great when they follow you around and they leap out of the water and stuff as you're boating around. Super fun. So I think some of the other map generators are actually a little more updated. For example, I think Amidst will actually function in with 1.13 seeds, and it will show you where things like frozen oceans and coral reefs and things are. But that is a tool you have to download and install for your computer, so it's a completely separate thing. If you feel like just using a map overviewer that's available on the web, that's my preferred way of doing things anyway. It's not like a hard and fast rule, but it is something that you need to be aware of. Now, we've reached the land here, and I think we will probably make a quick trek overland. I think we should be able to find the village if we just make a beeline in this direction, and we can always explore some of the stuff here as we go. So there's a nice little forest here. We've got some birch and oak trees. We've got some wolves hanging out nearby. I did not bring any bones with me, so we're not going to be able to tame ourselves a dog right now. The tiger, and on the other side of the tiger, we should hopefully find ourselves in a plains biome where there may or may not be a village. And here we go, we've come across a village. Fantastic stuff. Now, villages can take all kinds of shapes and sizes, and they are populated by villagers. These are kind of NPC characters in the game who have different occupations and will trade with you for various items or emeralds. Now, right now, this butcher is asking me for a trade of raw pork chops or raw chicken in exchange for one emerald, which is a little bit steep, and I don't have a great deal of that kind of material on me, but there are a few pigs around, so we could always try and kill a few of these pigs so that we have enough material to trade with the villager. But I've only got 4 raw pork chops, and I don't see that many pigs around, so it might actually be a little bit more effective if we wanted to breed the pigs together, start a little pig farm, and then trade with this guy afterwards. But there are a variety of villager professions. This chap over here is a cartographer. He's the kind of person who will trade us for paper for emeralds, and then later on we'll be able to buy things like compasses and maps from him, that kind of thing. There are a few other people in this village which I will check out, but the village buildings generate in a variety of shapes and sizes. You'll find one here that's got a bunch of books in it, which usually guarantees that there is going to be a librarian villager around here somewhere, although the cartographer with his white coat looks exactly the same, and that will kind of match the description. Let me see, there's probably a priest in here somewhere. Yes, hello, you are a cleric. Clerics will trade you rotten flesh from zombies, or alternatively gold for emeralds, and these are actually some of the more useful trades to have, because if you are able to trade away all of your rotten flesh, which otherwise serves no real purpose, it can't be used for crafting or anything like that, and it is not the best food stuff, clerics allow you to get money for that. They're effectively sort of zombie hunters, which is really fun to have in the game. That is the butcher we spoke to earlier. Let's see. These folks with the black aprons are either toolsmiths, armorers, or weaponsmiths. And they, this one actually, oh, that's a good trade. This one actually will have a coal trade. You can trade coal for emeralds, but they will also start to open up trades where you can trade emeralds for items. And in this case, that's allowing us to get a silk touch shovel, which is not something we have available to us in the game yet. So you know what? I might give that a go. Thank you very much for that. And we got our What a Deal advancement for that as well. Having a silk touch shovel is going to be a superb addition. Now, you'll notice that these pink particles came off of him and a few green particles there as well. What this means, the pink particles are actually regeneration. So if the villager has taken any damage, that means that they heal up a little bit. And this happens every time you perform a successful trade with them. And then after you've done a few successful trades, sometimes it will take a little while to show up. But eventually that means that they will refresh their trades. So any trades that you've done with them that will lock up can actually be reopened, and it will open up additional trades for you. So here the toolsmith is now asking for 9 iron ingots for an emerald or 10 emeralds for an unbreaking 2 iron pickaxe, which is not the best trade in the world again, but it's worth having maybe. Now you'll notice I can't go any further right until I've done a couple more trades with this guy. Eventually he will run out. Usually these guys have about 7 or 8 trades that they can do, and that will be about it. But you'll notice night is falling right now. We might actually sleep for the night, even though I said that I wouldn't, because the problem with villagers is that they are a little bit fragile and can't defend themselves. And as you can see, they're all dashing to get indoors now, because when night falls in a village, there is a chance that it can be attacked by zombies. And if you have too many villagers around and they get attacked by zombies, there's a chance of them turning into zombie villagers, which means you won't be able to trade with them. They will attack you, and in some cases, you will have to fight them. So that's actually probably a good reason for us to sleep here now. We've actually encountered the village. Good thing I brought that bed with me, wasn't it? Now let's hop in here and take a look at these other two white-coated fellas. There's a cartographer and another cartographer. Fantastic. Where are the librarians? Because librarians are perhaps one of the more sought-out villager classes. They are the people who will trade you for enchanted books, and they will trade a variety of materials for that. You can get paper to them, for example. There we go. We've got a librarian who will trade 24 paper for a single emerald. That is an incredible trade. And he's got a book and 8 emeralds for a sweeping edge enchantment. You know what? You're a keeper. I really want to keep this guy alive. So there are a couple of different ways we can do that to make sure that this librarian stays alive. And if we visit this place regularly, then he won't be attacked by zombies or anything like that. One of the most effective ways I have found is simply to dig a hole and put them in it, which seems a little bit barbaric, to be honest. But quite frankly, it is one of the safer ways of keeping them safe. Now, I will pop a block over the top here to make sure no zombies get in there. I don't have any blocks on me right now, so I will have to... Let's dig a block out of the corner of this well. How about that? And this chap here has a torch in there with him now. I placed a torch down there to make sure that no hostile mobs will spawn in the same space as him, because if a zombie got in there, somehow that would be very, very bad for us. But I'm going to put a block over the top of his head like so. We can still see him through the gap in the grass path there, so we know he's doing okay. But villagers don't need to eat or anything like that. Like other mobs, they don't really require anything for sustenance. You'll see mobs like cows and sheep grazing on the grass occasionally, but they don't actually need to do that in order to stay alive. And so what we've got here is a villager in a very protected cell, and hopefully, even if zombies come around to this village at some point, that guy will remain protected, because a trade for 24 paper for an emerald is actually going to be really useful to have. And since we have a sugarcane farm and we can make as much paper as we want, that basically means a limitless supply of emeralds. And it also allows us to unlock some more of his trades, which might potentially contain more useful enchanted books. So we will keep hold of that guy. I might even put a torch there just to kind of pinpoint the fact that we have trapped a villager down there and he is going to be of use to us. Let's take a quick look around at the other inhabitants of the village. What about you? You seem to be trapped down there already. Oh, you're another cartographer. Why is this village full of cartographers? No worries. That's the same butcher as before, or at least somebody with a very similar trade. We have another cleric over here as well, although I think that's not the same cleric as we saw in the church before, because he has a different rotten flesh trade. Generally speaking, when you're looking around at these villages and seeing if you can get some decent trades, you're looking for the lowest number here as possible, because then if you trade 36 rotten flesh to this guy repeatedly for emeralds, then it's going to be better than the 37 rotten flesh trade, because you'll get more emeralds for less rotten flesh. You'll notice that these guys also have extensive farms out here, so these can be a fantastic resource if you have not already acquired things like carrots and potatoes from fighting zombies or found the seeds in minecart chests or anything like that. You'll also find beetroot growing here, and I'm pretty sure we only found beetroot through one of the seeds in a minecart chest as well, so chances are you might not have encountered any crops before you come across a village, in which case, grab as much food as you care to from here, and maybe consider replanting them so that A, the villagers can have some food in the kind of roleplay situation here, which, like I said, they don't really need, or alternatively you can just farm this place as much as you want, and eventually you will end up with a whole bunch of crops, and a village is actually a really good place to start out in a Minecraft world. There are houses available for you here if you wanted to get some sleep for the night. You could even claim one of these houses as your own if you felt like it. But one thing to keep in mind is that some of these houses are so big and contain so little light that sometimes monsters might spawn in here even in the daytime. So with these larger village houses, it's often a good idea to light the place up a little bit beforehand just to make sure that there are no dark spaces in here. Now, these two are clerics. Again, that one has a 40 rotten flesh trade. That one has a 36, which is going to be a lot better. But a lot of these are worth keeping around because some of the trades they have later on in their sort of trading cycle, in their variety of trades, will actually be very useful to you. We'll get exactly into what each of these professions does in a future episode, but I think it is fantastic that we have now found a village. There is one last guy that I wanted to track down, and here he is over here. This guy does not have any trades at all. The green-coated villagers, if you right-click on them, do not do anything. And that is because they are nitwits. They are essentially the village idiot. They don't have any kind of professions attached to them. These were actually the first Minecraft villager, I think, to be implemented, at least with this current design. And they were originally just kind of NPCs walking around. They didn't serve any purpose. They were removed from the game a while ago. This is a bit of a Minecraft history lesson for you. They were removed from the game a while ago when the other villager professions were added, and everybody wanted these green-coated villagers to come back. They re-added them in a previous version, I think probably in Minecraft 1.10 or something like that, but since then they have served absolutely no purpose. They still act as a functional villager for the other things that villagers do, which we will get to that in future, but as of right now they don't have any actual profession. They just kind of wander around socializing with the other villagers and talking to them. What are you? You're a toolsmith? Oh, you're the one with the silk touch shovel. Okay, there was another guy with a black apron over here who we can also check out, see what he's got. Aha, a weaponsmith. Okay, so he will sell us an unenchanted iron axe right now, and in future they might be able to sell us some enchanted diamond swords and things like that. And finally, we have a shepherd. Okay, this is good, because these guys here, with the brown coats, they've got no apron or anything on, they are typically the ones who you'll find tending the fields over there. And they are usually either shepherds, fletchers, fishermen, or farmers. These brown-coated villagers are kind of essential for creating a villager breeder, which allows you to basically breed villagers together. They don't work in the same way as animals, though. These are these are people, and they do not breed in the same way as animals. You can't give two of them an emerald and expect them to get it on. That's not how it works. So we can make a contraption or a kind of like a holding cell for them that will allow them to breed together and breed new villagers with new professions and so forth, but that is going to take a lot of work, and that is something we are going to potentially work on in a future episode. But for now, it's just great to know that this village is here and that it has a few resources for us to claim, a few excellent trades, and a bunch of villagers that we would really like to keep alive. I think that's going to do it for today. I think we have done enough. We have seen our first kind of introduction to villagers, and these guys are kind of adorable. Let's be real. Let's take a selfie with them before we go. All right, folks, thank you so much for watching the Minecraft Survival Guide. My name has been Pixlriffs. Please don't forget to leave a like on this episode if you enjoyed it. Subscribe if you want to see more, and I'll see you guys soon. Take care. Bye for now.